Okay, I think we got a reasonably good number of participants. Thank you for joining this session. I want this session to be more interactive. So it's not like I'm doing any teaching or preaching, okay? So I'm learning along with you data science. So that's what my goal. So the background, I'm a software developer. I worked on multiple projects. But what I thought is, okay, data science is a field, machine learning is a field where people want to explore, okay? And I thought, okay, this is the domain where I want to, and this is a place what I thought, okay, I'm going to guide. So essentially how this course goes, I'm going to introduce you. So if you see the course structure, right, we have mainly five parts, okay? Any data science project, or if you take, okay, you essentially what you have to do is you have to collect data, okay? We call it as a data collection or data preparation. So don't focus about these jargons. I'm going to explain them with a simple example, okay? So how do we collect data? Data is everywhere. So I'm not going to go with how we are producing data, okay, what are the advantages of data, what the insights we are going to get into the data. You might have gone through multiple online coachings around that, right? So specifically, I'll focus more on a typical data science project life cycle and stuff. So I'm not going to teach you about data science, why we have to learn, what are the job opportunities around it, okay, what is machine learning. So those are all things I'm not going to do a marketing side of it. I'll focus more into a mathematical and a problem solving space of it, okay? So first phase is like, if you want to do any data science project, you need to have a data collection, okay? You need to collect the data. Data will be available. You need to prepare the data. So this is the first part. If you see, in our course, we focus on the data preparation, okay? So I'm going to explain you details later, okay? Once we have, okay, so then what we will do is we'll definitely create some model. I'll explain you what is a model itself, okay? It is nothing but a data model is nothing but a logic, if you can think, okay? Something like, okay, some information that is deduced from data. You have a data and you want to get information out of it, okay? That you can treat this something like a model, okay? So after we have a data model, okay, is it right or wrong, okay? Is it behaving in whatever the way we expect? So that's the next step in the course. What we are going to cover is like, there is a length in modeling, okay? What we covered is a model evaluation and maintenance. So we will see whether our model is working as expected. We call it a model evaluation and maintenance, okay? Over the period, what is the problems a typical a model will have? And other thing what you will have is a visualization. So whatever your findings, you found it in data, how do you represent back to the people and explain? Okay, so this is roughly the course outline. So traditionally, how do we program? So like, if I ask you, traditionally people gave us rules. From rules, we use those rules and written a program, right? So how do we do a traditional programming? For example, I'll give you an example. So if someone is greater than a height of 190, greater than ankle, I'll say him as the tallest. So this is a rule, right? If a height is greater than 190, this is a rule. Okay, we have an algorithm or rules at front. If you see the way we started programming, people gave us the rules. Then what we do is, okay, we take input, apply that rule, and we get output, right? This is how a traditional programming works. You will have an algorithm, you take input, you apply to that algorithm, you give that input and it gives you an output. So this is what about a traditional programming. But what this machine learning or data science do about? Okay. So now we have a data. There is a data. We have a data. And now we are going to build rules. So we are going to extract, we are going to identify patterns. Identify patterns in data and build rules. So essentially what you are writing a new rules. So essentially if you have a rule, okay, input, you give input and there is a rule engine and you get an output. So so in data science, how it works is like you have a data, you analyze patterns in that data and you build a model. Okay, rules are nothing but a model. Okay, a model will take input, you give an input and you'll get an output and you'll see the validation, it is output is right or not. If output is not right, you will enhance your rules. So it's nothing but machine learning. How machines learns it, machine takes the rules from the data. That's the only, the other way of looking at a problem. So you don't give rules to the machine, machine try to identify rules from the data. That is what a typical machine learning means. Okay, so any questions you have? Am I audible? Okay, so can someone text me on the chat? Am I audible? Okay, good. So sure. Now I'll give you one simple data set. Okay, guys, you need to guess what you know this very well. Okay, if I give a series of number 150, 155, 160, 165, 170. So what will be the next number? If you don't want to say it to me, you can text me in the group chat. 175, perfect. So how do you guys figure it out? The next number will be 175. How do you know that? You learned from, yes, based on the pattern. You learned from the data. Okay, how did you identified the data and you learned from that data? There is an, I can see a pattern here. Okay, and where the pattern here is, they are adding, what is the pattern here? They are adding plus 5. They are adding nothing but they are adding plus 5. And the next number you are getting. So traditionally what in our, if you want to program this, what we will say, okay, what we will say is if we will take x and we will say x equal to x plus 5, something like that. Okay. This is what we do. Someone gives us 160, we'll plus it and give it as a 165. This is a traditional programming, okay? But let us see how do we convert that into a machine learning. So if a machine has to identify some pattern, some logic in this data, how it is identified, let me explain. Okay, let us go to very basics of our linear algebra, okay, our graphical theory. Okay, so let me say one thing, okay? So if you see, I'll explain you very simple way, okay? So if this is our x-axis, right? This is x and this is y. Bear with me, even my drawing is very poor. I'm trying to learn this new scratch pad, okay? So for 0, how much we have? 150. For 1, it is 155, okay? And for 2, it is 160. Okay, and for 3, I'm not going to draw, this is y-axis, x-axis, I have 150, 165, and 10, 123 like that. So this is the point. For 1, we got 155, for 2 got 160, and 3 we got 165. So if you draw a line, you can see there is a relation between x and y, right? So you see 0, 1, 2, 3. if I try to turn into a very fun analogy, right, I'll just say, so the numbers what I showed you here is like 150, 155, 160. So let us say you go to a bank in a line and you don't carry any money, they give you 150 rupees. So nothing but if you take 0 rupees, if you take zero, you go and stand in a line, the bank gives you 150. Okay, if you take 1 rupee, they give you 155 rupees. If they gave you, take you 2 rupees, they give you 160. If you take 3 rupees, they give you 165 rupees. So if someone asks you, if I take 10 rupees, how much I'll get now? Can someone ask me, I take a 10 rupees to the bank and sit in the line. They follow this logic. Okay, how much I'll get it? Is something which we need to do a prediction. That is what we call, it's a prediction, right? We need to predict. How do you predict? On a particular rule. So if I take 200, if I take 10 rupees, so bank will give 200. Why bank will give 200? Because it follows this linear equation. Let us try to solve this linear equation. Okay. So we learned there is a linear in relationship, right? So as X grows, your Y is also grows. So you saw that it's nothing but a linearly incrementing it. Okay. So traditionally we know our linear algebra, right? It's nothing but Y is equal to MX plus C. It's nothing but how do you define this line? This line, you define it with the Y equal to MX plus C. A straight line, this is nothing but a straight line. I gave 0 rupees, bank. I went with the 0 rupees to the bank. I stood in the line, they gave me 150. Obviously no banks do that. Okay, it's like I'm just a hypothetical. If I take 1 rupee and give it to the bank immediately gave me 155. So what we are trying to do is, okay, there is a data and we are trying to find a logic, nothing but this equation. So if in our mathematics world, very, very easy, right? If you say M's, I'll just show you. Okay, what is M? Slope equal to Y2 minus Y1 by X2 minus X1. So by the way, I don't teach math more here, but I just want to show you an intuition behind this. Okay, so it is nothing but a slope is nothing but the linear way of increasing it. Okay, the linear way the data is increasing. It's nothing but a slope. We call it a slope, how it is increasing it. And this is called intercept, right? So what is here in this point? What is X0, Y150? That is nothing but X1, Y1. And what is the next point here? Here it is like X2, 1 and Y2 is 155. So it's, if you compute, right, 150 Y2 minus Y1 by X2 minus X1. Nothing but 5. So Y equal to what is M? 5. X plus what is C? The slope. The slope is nothing but if you don't take anything to the bank, they will give you intercept 150. So Y equal to 5X plus C is the equation. This is the logic the bank is following now. So now if I take 10 rupees, how much I get? 5 into 10 plus 150 is nothing but 200. Let me draw it in a new page. So the linear equation we got from above data is equal to Y equal to Y equal to 5X plus 150. So this is a straight line which goes through, not getting completely. Okay. Can you ask the question? Unmute and ask me a question. Good. So if you are not getting, don't hesitate to ask me a question. Someone said that Dell. Okay. I couldn't get. Okay. Can you ask me the question? No problem. let us make this interactive. If you are not getting me, someone will in the team will also definitely get, won't get it. Okay.
Yeah. How to get this formula?
Yes. How do you got this formula is the first question. Okay. So why, how do you got this y equal to mx plus c is a formula. If you see, I'll once again explain you. Anyhow, data science is not about learning formulas, but I just want to show you some intuition behind it. Okay. So what happens is we have numbers 150, 155, 160 and 165. Okay. So when we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. So the relation is when you have 0, this is a straight line. So we learn the formula for a straight line is this, right? Y equal to mx plus c. How do you got this problem? Formula is nothing but there is a so much of theoretical concept. There is a so much of mathematics behind it. Okay, we even I don't know, to be honest. Okay, so how this formula is deduced? But a simple linear equation. We call this as a linear equation, right? So life is not always linear, but this data point shows the linear equation. So here, then we computed. Then we have. Then we know what is a slope and what is an intercept. Intercept is nothing but where it cuts the x-axis. Sorry, where it cuts the y-axis at a particular 0 point. So if it cuts here, so this is nothing but x-intercept. Okay, so it is nothing but 150. And we already know slope equal to y2 minus y1 by x2 minus x1. So this we already know. Okay. I'll mute all. So we already got the slope as pi. So essentially the final equation, what we got is like y equal to 5x plus 150. So now the first question someone asked me, I am learning data science. Should I need to learn all these formulas? Okay, should I need to learn the linear regression, polynomial regression? Okay, should I need to learn algebra, matrix calculation? I'm saying nothing. You guys really need not to know the formulas behind it. You need to know the intuition. When you see the data, right? When you see the data, okay, which algorithm should I use to get these solutions is important things. The main thing is how the whole data science world revolves. 90% of the work, okay, 90, I can say 95% of time, which algorithm should I use a linear equation or linear regression, or should I use a random forest or something? I'm going to cover those, okay, but leave about it. Which algorithm should I use is the one which always is a confusing factor for the people. For that, you need to know the data better, okay, how data is behaving. So I, based on this graph, right, I draw this graph and I found this is a linear equation. So I thought linear equation is the right algorithm for to solve this problem. So that's the reason I thought, okay, why my linear regressor should I use to find it out? Okay, so now what I'm going to teach you is, so this is how we found a mathematical formula, right? So the final formula, what we found for this data set, okay, 150, 155 is nothing but y equal to slope is 5 and x and c intercept is 150. This is what we figure it out. Now, what are the prerequisite to learn data science? So someone asked me the question. So to learn the data science, what is a prerequisite I need to have? So what I say is, okay, so first you need to have a passion. That's the reason you guys joined this session. I'm glad. So you will certainly pay some attention. You'll become a data scientist. It's not really a machine learning engineering or something like that. Okay. It's not really tough. So one programming language for sure. Okay. I suggest learn Python. So Python or R, there are two programming languages where people use in data science, but my suggestion is go towards Python, because Python is not only used in data science. Python has a very broader scope. Now people were using Python in web application development. Okay. People were using in infrastructure management. Okay. So like Ansible, those all things were also written in Python. So if you learn Python, if you don't get a data science job, but the future of application development happens in Python, you'll definitely crack it. Okay. So learn Python, which is used everywhere. Then, so learn statistics little bit. Okay, this course, I have a statistics refresher. Or I'm saying elemental mathematics. So we need to learn little bit of linear algebra and matrices, but I'm not going to cover how do you do that, but why to learn them, you are going to understand that. Okay, then one visualization tool. So when someone gives you data, right, 90% of the time, 90% or I can say 75% of the time, people spend time in organizing data. Okay, understanding data. So you need to have a visualization tool like Tableau. Very powerful visualization tool. When I explore you, very popular data sets, I'll show you how can you use Tableau. So prerequisites, Python you should try to learn as a basics. In the next week, I'm going to start a Python session specifically for the data science people, which is going to run for 2 to 3 weeks from 1:30 to 2:30. If you are in my group, you will get that details as well. So that's bit about a prerequisite for this session you want to understand. You nearly need not to know Tableau, but I'm going to teach that. You have to learn a little bit Python, because this I won't focus on Python much here. I focus on using Python to solve that problem. And statistics are something which I'm going to teach you. You'll understand. Okay. So now let us take our simple data set. Whatever the data set we had, right? So this is a data set which I have. Let me represent that in a CSV. So so whatever the data I have, right, I represented, I put it in a CSV and I'm going to show you. So, and we are going to solve this, the prediction problem. Okay. If someone gives 9, 10, 11, 12, okay, what are those values I'm going to get using Python? So essentially what happens is you have a data. You are not going to write a rules. Okay. So the rules are computed by the computer. Okay, the algorithm is going to compute the rule, and that we call it as a model. So we'll create a model, and after that, if you give input, it will predict the output. So we will see how it is predicting, and we will see the evaluating that model, whether this model is rightly predicting it or not. The rules, what it predicted by the computer is right or not. That's what a machine learning. So you give the data, you say, this is, someone said, okay, bank is giving, if you don't go and stand in the line, it is giving 150 rupees. If you take 3 rupees, they are giving 165 rupees. Okay. Now someone asks, I take 1,000 rupees. Okay. How much bank gives to me? Let us try to solve with a machine. We don't teach the machine. Machine will find the rule, and we are going to use Python to do that. Okay, so you got the problem, right? Now, someone asked me, so in Python, this entire course is taught in Python. Okay, so in Python, we have little bit of libraries, okay, data science libraries, which we use. So we call it a NumPy. As of now, you remember those names, Pandas. These are, and sklearn. These are the libraries, data science libraries we use. Okay, and we use another library, Matplotlib, for visualization. Or Seaborn is another library which you are going to use it for visualization. Okay. Now, so how I'm going to share you the entire course is, if you go to GitHub, whatever the data set I'm using, so I have my repo, I have a data science. So I have a data science crash course in this, whatever the classes I finished, right? The Python files I'm going to search there. So if you go into the GitHub and clone this repository, data science crash course, whatever I teach here, you guys are going to get it. And do give a star to this repository so that the searches for this repository go up moving forward. Okay, whenever you are trying to clone, just give a star to this. Keeping that aside, now, so if you use Python, essentially we have a Python. We use, these are the words you use: IPython, Spider, Jupyter, J-U-P-Y-T-E-R. Okay, so and you hear about PyCharm. So when you have a Python as a language, so these are the, I can say Spider and PyCharm are, and Jupyter, these are all IDEs. So IDE is nothing but an integrated development. And if you are trying to develop something in Python, right? So you need an IDE, which is nothing but you have an editor, you will have a debugger, you have a compiler and everything together. So we use, this session is taught with Spider. Okay, we use Spider IDE, and sometimes I use Jupyter also. Jupyter is like a notebooks, they call it as. So once we started learning why Jupyter notebooks are a lot easier to share across the people than Spider, than the Python code, you will understand, okay? So we will cover both Spider and Jupyter. Now, let me show you one. This is a data set you have. So till now, are you able to follow? If anyone has any questions. No? Okay, good. So now let me try to write a small Python program and try to explain you how do you build a machine learning model for the data set. So let me open the Spider. I'm going to show you last section of this course, how do you install prerequisite software for this session. So I'm not going to cover now because that takes a little bit of time. So what I'm going to show you is, okay, I just say Spider, I'm bringing up the Spider IDE up. I should have opened it prior, bear with me. So till it comes up, you might have heard about Python and IPython, right? So IPython is nothing but an interactive Python. So when you simply say, when you simply say Python, you are going to get a Python prompt. Okay, this is called, they call it a REPL. Here you can run your Python code. Like if I ask Python to do 2 addition, 1 plus 10, it is doing 11. So like our shell, right? Like our Linux shell or something like that. You can treat this as a Python REPL or Python shell. So this is a typical Python. When you start writing, running a Python, it will give you a shell. If you give a script, it will execute that script. Then there is something called IPython, okay, which is nothing but an interactive Python. So it gives you a lot many visualization features and stuff. Okay, then there comes this Spider IDE. And here we write the code. Okay. Yes. So Spider is a freeware. It's which comes with an Anaconda distribution. So if I want to get Spider, someone asked me what can I do? Okay, when you want to install Python, so this course, entire course is taught using Anaconda Python. Okay, try to be interactive. Ask me more questions because YouTube has so many data science courses. You can open a YouTube and follow through it, okay? But that won't solve you. You won't get to time to speak with the teacher, right? So this is the place you need to interact with me more so that others will get benefited also. So you can use Anaconda Python and try to download the appropriate version, and you are going to get the whole pack. So which will have, so all you need to use is Anaconda Python, which will have a Python interpreter plus IDEs plus data science libraries. I'm going to cover that in last 10 minutes. Okay. So let me go to the Spider and try to write some. If you don't get it also, don't worry. So import numpy as np. These are like, I'm first step, what you do is you will import essential libraries. Import pandas as pd, import matplotlib.pyplot as plot. Import. So these are the essential libraries which we need to use. Okay, now let us try to read the data. So whatever the data we have, right? So this is the data, right? 0, 150. So now let us try to read that data set. So you can use read CSV. Okay. So, and the file name, I forgot the file name. Let me. So my first data model .csv, I'm trying to use it. And I'll say headers equal to none. What I'm trying to do is, the first step in any data science project is like data exploration. I'm not building the logic now. I'm not building the model. I'm not building the rule. So the first step, what we are trying to do here is extract the data, read the data and organize it. Okay. It is already organized data. So we don't read. So we are reading from the data. And we are organizing it, and we are trying to visualize it. So, okay, we are going to try to visualize it. Okay, so it means understanding, is it data is really related or not? Okay, so what I mean by that, if I show you, I'll explain, you'll understand. So now I have a date. Sorry, set console working directory. I'll save this file so that currently. Okay, so you see here spider, I'll explain a little bit spider. This is your IDE. You write your code here. Then you have a variable explorer where you see the variables created here. I have a data set variable which I created. This is called variable explorer. You can see your variables. And this is the Python console. And the third quadrant here we have, right? This is a Python console. Now, if you see, this is the data set. So someone gave 0, they got 150. Someone gave 5 rupees, they got 175 rupees. So if you see numbers like this, right? It's very tough to understand relation between them. Okay, so what we can do, we can draw a graph. So if you draw a graph, then you will understand there is a relation between these two. So now what we will do is, so what I'll do is, I'll take X. There is a small convention you will understand. Ignore these all essentially, what I am taking is I am calling these are X and Y. So if you see the data set, this is X axis. And if you see my graph, whatever I represented earlier, X axis is nothing but a 0, 1, 2, 3. And Y axis is nothing but 150, 160, 155. So that is what I try to do here. I had two variables, X and Y. Okay, so there is a specific name for it. Okay, so X here we call X as independent variable. Pay attention to this one statement. You will hear a lot about this independent variables and dependent variables. Why we call it a dependent variable? Okay. So our prediction, okay, our predictor, we shouldn't call it a predict. I'm little bit confused with this vocabulary, but I'll correct that, okay. You call it a dependent or predicted variable. You need to predict this, okay. So X is free. You give 150, 140, 160, 170. It doesn't mean. So it's an independent variable. If you see our mathematical equation, Y equal to MX plus C, X is independent and Y is dependent. So generally people use capital X for independent variables. Okay. So few people, if you are coming from business analytics background, you can call this as a dimension and Y is called measure. So when I explain you visualization, you will understand. But remember these vocabularies. Okay. So X is independent. You can give anything into it, 130, 170, anything. But Y is nothing but which is a dependent. If you change X, Y will change. But it's X is nothing but independent. It's free. That's what about independent and dependent variable. Now what I'll see is let me draw a graph to see whether there is any relation between them or not. Okay. Plot dot scatter. Okay, I'll say X comma Y and I'll say color equal to some green. Okay, so let me run this piece of code. To run this piece of code, select it and say shift enter. It runs the code and figure is ready. So if you see, there is a relation, right? If 0, 151, 155, 2, 163, 165. So there is a relation between X and Y. All of a sudden, if I try to draw like this, I'll change the data now, you see, you'll understand. So I'll just change this as minus 155, minus 170. Okay. And use text CSV format. And I'll replot the graph. I changed a few values. Now the figure is ready. And you see, is there any relation now? There do some relation, but it's not a linear relation. So the whole figure got changed. Your zero became here. Okay. Now if someone take 1 rupee to the bank is going to kill you and take 150 rupees back from you. So visualization is such a beautiful tool to explain your relation between your data. Okay, so what is the relation you have it in data? Now someone took 4 rupees into the bank and bank also took some 100 or 200 back from him. Okay, so essentially it is like this. It came down, then once again it went, then once again it came down, then once again it was. So this 1 and 4 is nothing but a bad data or outlier. You hear, right? So why, okay, everything, this, all the 5 dots are in the same line. Why these 2 values are outlier? Okay, why someone one took take 4 rupees and went to the bank, they was giving minus 200. Okay, someone took 1 rupee to the bank and they gave minus 150. Why for rest of the people, they are giving money, but why only for 1 rupee and 4 rupee, they are not giving money? Okay, this sight of intuitions you are going to get when you go with a visualization. So visualization plays a very important role. Okay, so certainly you think that 1 and 4 are outlier. Okay, you saw this one by looking at into the graph, but you cannot look by your eyes and find an outliers in your data, right? Bad data in your data set. How can you do that? That we come with a standard deviation and outliers box plot. Okay, when I dealt with the statistics, okay, so the normal distributions, when I speak about that, okay, if someone sees a data, okay, is it an outlier or real data? Is it a data or it's a corrupted data? You need to come to understand, okay, and remove that corrupted data or fix that corrupted data. So that what you want to do. So let me give one more, sorry. So all of a sudden in our data, 150 minus 1 minus 150 came. Okay, then 160, 155. So you are able to figure it out. Okay, minus 150 is an outlier by looking it into the graph visualization. So outliers can be found using statistical tests. Okay, very easily you can find with a statistical test. One simple example I'll give you. So someone said ages of human. Okay, someone have a data point 40, 60, 90, and suddenly and 10, 11. These are ages of the people. And suddenly someone wrote 190, and then once again 50, 48. Okay, 190. If someone asks, okay, 190 is wrong. I'm saying here now. How do you say 190 is wrong? Person cannot have 190 years age. I say that he cannot have, because I'm a human. I know no one. I have not seen no one. Survived for 190 years. But you need to have some mathematical way of finding that 190 is an outlier, right? That's what we come. The standard deviations comes into picture. Okay, that's what the statistical measures comes into picture. Any question you guys have? Statistical measures will help you to identify what are outliers. Okay, then if you get outlier, how do you normalize it? Okay, that we will learn that into an imputation. That's what we call it then. Okay, normalization or imputation in data science, we'll learn that. You have to correct. 190 is wrong. Someone stupid inputted, a developer inputted, or a data entry operator carelessly gave 190. 190 cannot be there. Okay, then we will have chi-square test, okay, F test. So to test your statistical significance of your analogy, you need to use the statistical test. So first of all, you guys lost, or are you with me? Okay, how do you find an outlier? Okay, so one is with visualization. Something visualization gives you, something with a statistical measure, you can do that. Okay, thank you. Thank you. So yeah, people replied me that they are with me. Okay. Yes. Now I found this is, I cannot come to a logic here. Okay. Until unless I fix that. So what I'll go back and just undo these two things and I'll come back. Okay. And let me redraw the diagram. And this is neat. This is certainly a neat. Okay. Now we learned the first step in data science is data preparation. Data collection. We collected data from, we took the data from, or data extraction, you can call it as, okay. Okay, then we analyzed it. Sorry, I shouldn't type here. I type it in another note so that I can share. I'll check in these notes also. Nana. Tarata. Okay. So this part of the code is nothing but data extraction. You took the data, good. Now what we'll do, we did some observations in it. Observations and analysis. For us, the data is good. We don't have anything problem. So the data is good for us. So we are not doing any further data pre-processing. So we don't need to do any pre-processing. Data is good. No pre-processing. Data is good. No pre-processing. What is pre-processing? Removing outliers. If you have bad data, remove from the data. I'm not doing data. How do you do data pre-processing? We'll cover. That's all together. I have a big section for it. Now I analyze the data. I process the data. Now comes the real interesting piece. So when you have a data, now you need to split. You need to split data. We split into train and test. Remember this vocabulary very well, very common. You got the data. Okay, what we do is we split the data into two parts, train and test. So what happens is we use that train data. We use train data and create model. We use test data and validate the model. You got my point? So if someone gives you data, you have to split that data into a ratio. Okay, for example, I'll have 80 to 20 ratio, very common ratio. 75 to 25 is a very common ratio because sklearn library uses default as your test. So 75 used to train the data and 25 used to test your model, okay, whether it is working fine or not. Okay, so when someone gave you data, you need to split into 3/4 and 1/4. 3/4 is for your training the model or creating the model, and 1/4 is for your validation, whether your model is working or not. Okay, so now let me split my data into train and test. So in very simple to do that, from sk learn dot model selection import train test split. This percentage is not sure just for, no, there is no industry standard as such. If you see, the libraries generally follow a common pattern. Okay, very people, what people do is they use 75-25. Okay, 75 to train and 25 to predict. Okay, few people can have whole 100% you try to train your model, then you will get, there is something called overfit. I'll explain you what is the problem. Why shouldn't I use 100% data to train my model? You will be bitten by overfit problem. I'll explain you what is meant by overfit. Means nothing but your model is trying to adapt to the data much. So if you give a new data, it won't work in a proper fashion. So we will learn that what is overfitting when you do the model evaluation. Okay, so if someone said I use all 100% and a new data it comes, it will predict accurately, that will not happen. That will have a overfit problem. Okay, so that's the reason you shouldn't use. And standard, there is no set standard. Generally library, what it does by default, we can treat it as a standard because a lot many people uses it. So, and yeah, getting back, I'm trying to x comma y comma, so then a simple way is like you can control I, you can learn, you can see what are the values it is going to take. So control I, if you press the function train test split is going to take these values. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say test size. My test size will be 0.25 and I'll have a random, there is a random state so that every time we run the code, it will be common for all. So random state equal to 0. Okay. So let me, okay. So if you go to back to the variable explorer,
hi Balaji.
Yes.
One small question before go for the train and test data. If the raw data contains some junk values, like there is no relation between the columns. Let me say, like I have given in the Y column as ABC characters, which doesn't make any sense. So do that refining of the data is the job of again the data scientist, or how?
Exactly right. It is the job of the data scientist. So for example, if I have 8, in the 8 field someone gave a ABC. So now should I delete this 8, or should I identified it cannot be text, it can be an integer, but what should I do? Okay. What value should 8 should have? Okay. So someone says, okay, should I put an average here? Average of this whole data? Should I need to put, or should I delete the data? In the data science world, 99% of that, not 90, I shouldn't say 99, 90% of the science, we won't delete the data. We try to predict, okay. We try to impute the, you try to remove the anomalies and put a right content. So simple thing, what we can say is, okay. Instead of someone say put 0, you won't agree. If you put 0, then the whole logic will go. Someone says, okay, let's put average. Should we use average? Should we use median? Should we use mode, or should we use a standard computation or a standard deviation plus affinity? Okay, what parameter you need to impute, that we cover as a part of data imputation. Okay, so that what we call it's a data imputation, and it is very much the responsibility of a data scientist.
Can I ask you one thing on this? So can I put these kind of rows apart and I run the test? Can I include, let me say, like I have done with my model. So later, can I add these rows as a train data?
Okay. So the question what someone asked me is, okay, fine. This is a, this is bad. ABC is there. Let me ignore this column. Let me ignore this row, sorry. Ignore this row, and I use, because rest of the data is fine. What I'm going to is, I'm going to split this as a train and test, and trying to compute, create a model, and I try to predict the value of 8, what will be the appropriate value of 8. Okay.
Correct.
Okay. That is what a question someone asked me. Very, very valid. Okay. I'm not saying you shouldn't do that. Okay. So in a, so should we go for the statistical measure of adding a value here, or ignoring the data elements and trying to use the predictor to predict the value to it, is a choice which we make. Okay. So in my case, what I suggest you is, okay, don't try to delete the data. Use statistical measure to impute the data and use it as a part of a train and test. Okay. Let me give you an example. Okay. All of a sudden, bank thought, okay, someone comes with 8 rupees. I'm not going to give them 190, I'm going to give them 170 only. Or they say, if there, someone comes with a 188 rupees also, I'll give 185 only. And someone gives a 9 rupees also, I'll give 185 only. Okay, that's what the bank thought. They kept upper limit on top of it. It's not linear. The line, if I want to show you, okay, if I want to show you, the line is not like this. It went somewhere like this. After that, it became flat. Okay, then your equation is not y equal to mx plus c anymore. Okay, someone is getting, someone took 200 rupees and went into the bank. He was only, he has to get only 180 rupees. Okay, he's not going to get 200. So what I'm saying is, if you want to impute the data, impute with the statistical measures. Don't try to use it as a predictor and try to predict a value and put it. So you will lose the significance of that data point. Never delete a data point. Use statistical measure to impute the value and try to predict that. Okay. So that's my conclusion. So to be honest, there is no hard and fast rules in this data science. That's the reason people get confused. So my entire, I want to dedicate much time in giving you intuitions right, not the maths behind it. This is not a math session at all. Okay. So this is about giving you intuitions and the right library. Okay. Let me go back to my Python code. Okay, so let me clear the variables. Now, something seriously went wrong. Whatever I wrote, I'll just copy paste the code. Taman alert check nana. Okay. So instead of wasting time on debugging on what I, when I type wrong, I'll just go back to the pre-written code and I'll show you. I'll remove. So what we did is, now I did a 80-20 split and try to run this. So, oh man, I got the point. This data set is corrupted. That's the reason it is giving an error. It's not the algorithm problem, the data problem. Now it's a good example for our data exploration. So bear with me, this open with other application. Okay, let me fix. It has some empty rows and which corrupted the whole. Okay, going back to my Python, my spider IDE. Clear the variables and now let me, okay, great. So if you see now, what I said here is like I did the test is like 20% and the train is 80%. So I splitted the, if you see X test, I got only two values. Okay. And if X train, I split it, I got the six, rest of the six values. So if you see the data set, I have totally, the 9, okay, I corrupted this also, 190, 195, 200. Okay, I should be a little bit cautious when I am doing this, because to explain, I corrupted the data and that whole data set was missed out. Let me rerun this. So I have 10 items. Okay, so the first 8, 0 to 7, I'm going to use it for train, and 8, 9 is for my test. So this is my data set. That's what I've tried to do. So if you see my train, okay, it randomly picks 0 to 7, index starts with. So 8 elements, I took it as a train. So X train and Y train. If you, I want to keep both adjacent to each other. Bear with me some more time. Prime. So someone took 5 rupees, they got 155. Someone took 0, they got 150. So this is X train and this is Y train. You guys understand? So I splitted the data into two. Y is a predictor and X is independent and Y is dependent. So X can take any value, you have to get Y. Okay, so this is now I splitted it into two sets, 80-20 ratio, all the records. Now let me try to use a linear regression, because I draw the scattered plot, right? If you see the plot, this is how the plot is. Okay, so it is like a relation. So then I thought, okay, this a linear equation. What is a train and a test mean? Okay. So when you here we use train to create or train our model or algorithm. What is meant by training? Okay, you didn't give the equation, right? You didn't said it. Bank is giving money in YMX, Y equal to 150, Y equal to 5X plus 150. You didn't say to them, You didn't say to them, you didn't say to program, you didn't programmatically did it. But program has to get that logic. It has to compute this linear equation. Okay, the algorithm has to compute this linear equation. That's what we call it's a curve fitting. Essentially, what it will do is, like, what this linear regression algorithm does it is like, so it will fit the curve. So 0, 150, 155, 156, 158, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So this week linear regression model is nothing but a curve fitting. It will try to fit the curve which touches majority of the data points. So that's what a linear regression is. Okay, the linear equation. Okay, linear regression is nothing but a curve fitting. You have a data points, you will fit the curve. So what those data points? You will have train data points, you fit the curve. You use the train points and training that model. So for example, real estate prices, okay? So for example, as years goes by, 9290, the house price is like 30,000. In 2000, it became 50,000. In 2010, all of a sudden, because of IT boom, it became 50 lakh. Okay, the curve is like this. It's not a straight line anymore. Okay, so it is following a logistic. There is a logic. Okay, it's following a logistic regression. Okay, so I'll explain you how this is nothing but a polynomial regression. Okay, so all you are doing is a curve fitting. When there is no curve at all, there is no relation. So someone has said, okay, after 2020, it becomes zero. So can you draw, this is a curve, this is a circle. Okay. So after 2020, if world ends, there is no real estate at all. So hypothetical, but I'm saying that is an outlier, we call it as someone has a data point. So essentially you use train data, you have a data set, someone give you a data, you will split that data, train data, you use to train model, you try to find that logic, and you use test to verify that logic. That's the only difference between train and test. Training the data, training the model, and using it your test to validate the model. So that's about train and test. Thank you, no problem. So see, for me it is so easy to explain you to get this. I read so many books, so many videos, okay, and I spent a lot. So no question is stupid question. Feel free to ask. There are very good videos in internet who teach far better than me, but they are not there available to answer your question. The only the way to meet this forum is an interactive coaching we are going to have. Okay. So
yeah.
Right now, don't focus on this law from Python. Leave about all those. Okay. Just I'm splitting this data. Now the first step what you did is data extraction. Let me mute all. Okay, somewhere I have a button to mute.
One question.
Give me more. Yes.
Yeah. On this 80%, only the first set of 80% will take it as train data, and the remaining 20% will take as a test data.
Exactly.
Okay.
So that's what this data set, right? So the first 0 to 7 will be train and rest needs to be test. But I depends upon the algorithm. I said random state equal to 0, right?
Okay.
Ideally the X train, if you see why it took only the 4, 9, randomly it picked 8, not in a sequential order. It can be anything. Okay, when you train a model, you need not to train it in a linear model. You can take the data point anywhere. Okay, it will try to find the equation. So it's not the order in which the data set is given. So if you say random state equal to something like 5, 3 or something like that, okay, it randomly selects 3. I really have to read what this random state mean. Okay, but very, very valid question. It's not that we always select in a sequential fashion. We can randomly pick 80%. 80% can be anything in that data set. Okay, now we did. I'm a Java developer and C developer, so I got that syntax very well. // Okay, so hash is a common syntax. And now train and test split. One program, if you spend 1 week on this, all other programs are same. Okay, the way we use the library is same. So in machine learning or data science, you won't learn so much of coding. The coding is very small part of it. Intuition is what you learn. Okay, so the template is same. I'll give you a template, whether it can be a logistic regression, it can be a decision tree, or it can be a random forest, it can be a support vector machine, all are same. The way the methodology you follow is same. You split the data, then you'll train. Now I am training my model. Okay, so I'm using linear regression. Okay, one function. Then I'm passing my X train and Y train. I'm giving my train data to this regressor function. Okay, these three steps you created a model. So if you see, if I put enter, my model got created. So what is your model? Your rule or model is this regressor object. This object is your model. So if you give now any input, new input to it, it will predict what is going to the output of it. Okay. So simple, three steps. From linear model, you import this function linear regressor. From the module linear model, we'll take a linear regressor. And fit is nothing but you are giving it to the training set. I gave X train and Y train. Reshape is, you will understand why I use reshape function here. When you try to simply pass X train, you will get an error, because if you have only one feature, we have only one independent variable. So if you have only one independent variable, the algorithm expects to reshape the data put data input data. It's nothing but what you are giving. You are giving one column. That's all. So it is asking, okay, when you, the train is nothing but 4, 5, 9, 8, and Y train is nothing but 170, 125. So you are giving both. You are giving both dependent and independent. Okay, nothing but this entire set, this entire data set from 0 here to here, you are giving it as a train. You got my point? So you are giving this X and Y to the algorithm, and algorithm trained. Now that algorithm got trained. So now algorithm is trained now. Now let us try to see how it is behaving. Now what I'll ask it is, I'll ask it to predict. So I'll simply say, so if someone take 10 rupees to the bank, this is our data set, right? So now someone takes 10 rupees to the bank, the money he should get? Okay, so what he should get is like 200. So this is what, let us see how it Y result. I'll say it says a Y, sorry, it fitted. Now we are going to predict Y result. Or I'll say simply as result. Great. So now if you see result, it predicted 205. Right. Where is the equation? You didn't give it is y equal to mx plus c. But how it predicted it, it fitted the curve. So if now I gave 10, then it gave 205. That is fine, right? As per our logic. Okay. So now, let me So now we created a model, and the model try to predict the values. So now let us try to see why predict. We have our test, right? Let us use our test data. So x underscore test. Okay. So what we'll do is we have to reshape -1 and -1. So why we preserved this? So for this x test, for 2 rupees and 8 rupees, y test, what we have to get? 160 and 195. Okay, let us see that y predict what it will give. Regressor dot predict. Sorry, it should be right. Let me debug what has happened wrong. Okay, I gave the -1 and 1 wrong, the reshape function. So what it gave? 159. Y prediction is like 159 and 194 it gave. Okay, so now let's go back to our y test. It is nearly equal with little bit of decimals. It has to predict. So why predict? What algorithm predicted is 159 rupees you are going to get, but actually you are getting 160, 159 point blah blah blah. Okay, 90. Okay, here it is saying 195 you are going to get. We got 194. So there is a small, your prediction algorithm is not, yeah, thank you, -1, 1. Okay, so your prediction algorithm is not correctly fitting it. So there is a margin of error. Okay. So how do you validate? Okay, how do you validate your model? Okay, is we are going to cover later. I think we are having another 15 minutes. I want to open up questions. So we created the model and we are testing the model. So, but we manually tested the model. So like this, if you want to see manually, there are hundreds of values. Okay, suppose your test data set has lakhs of value, where your train has a millions of value. You can't with a human eye validate that value, right? So we are going to have a validation also. Okay, a library which will validate against test and trying to compute the deviation with actuals and gives us how good your model is. There are false positives, false negatives. We are going to touch them when we do the model evaluation. So any questions till now?
So far, okay, like on the code and the programming, like the reshape, these methods, you'll come to know later.
Right, okay, don't focus on them. So what we did is the same thing. Data extraction, then what we did, we created, analyze and created the model. We analyzed with the scatter plot. So if you see the life cycle, right? If you see the life cycle, extract, organize, analyze, and present. Once again, this is a recursive model. If something is gone wrong, right, we try to organize the data better, like replacing bad values with the correct values, and we try to analyze, and we once again we do a presentation. So this is an iterative cycle, so it's not like a one single line. Okay, so any other questions anyone has on a data science project lifecycle modeling and a overview? This is like introductory session, so the next session will be like a lot faster. I'm going to move. So are you able to follow? Can I pick someone randomly? Ask Sheikh, are you able to follow me? Okay. Sure.
Yes, Balaji.
Sure. Don't hesitate to ask questions. So the essential of me being here is I will also learn from your questions. So I'm not a super data scientist. Okay. I have a formal degree in mathematics and also learning data science. So I can combine both. I'm a programmer and the mathematics formal degree, which combines both for me. Okay. So before I say thank you, I'll just prerequisite if someone I promised you, right? Okay, I'll show you one more tool also.
Bala, I have one question.
Yes.
Actually, when you're doing data science, right, which programming language is like suitable for data science? Is R or Python?
Python. My take is Python.
Why R?
Why R? Because R also has very good syntax. But R is only used in data science field. When you learn a language, you need to use in any other. In Python, I can write a web applications. In Python, I can do a data science. In Python, I can do infrastructure programming. Device driver programming, I can do. IoT devices, I can run. Python runs everywhere. So do you want to learn a language which is used everywhere, or do you want to limit yourself to a language which is used only specific place? So that's your choice. I'm not recommending that don't learn RAR or R is waste. Okay, R is also a very good language. In fact, I know R also. But here I just focus only on Python. I learned both. When I practice data science, I practice both. It's a syntax, right? What is there in it? Essentially, when people try to do this entire thing, they convert into Java and do it in a scalable fashion on a cloud, okay, deploying on a Docker containers and run them in a test scale when the algorithms they run. They choose a language, but you should choose a language which is very easy to start. Then when you need to scale, then people write it in C++ or Java, the entire algorithms, okay?
Yes, okay.
That's what, but I'm not saying don't read R if you are passionate in, but come with Python for at least 7 weeks. After that, you can learn R.
Yeah, Balaji, one more question. Like, do data scientists are going to write models or refine models?
All. It's not one job. It's all, okay? So you are going to refine model. What do you mean by refining model? Is you have to retrain the model. Model gets, as the time
Let
passes.
Let me say, like, my model is not efficient. Actually, let me say, like, right now regression model is not suitable for whatever the data set we did for. So
okay.
Anyway, I need to refine this model, right? I need to correct it, refine in sense.
Yeah. So you
That's
will say,
I mean.
Right, you're right. You just go with a logistic regression or something. Instead of linear model, you can use the logistic regression model or anything. So you can. So that's what a job of a data science. You are right. Both we do.
The question comes here. So as of now, we are trying already existing models, right? Like random forest, linear regression, backpropagation, whatever existing things. Are we going to do any which are not existed, like algorithm design kind of thing, or only we are using the existing capabilities of these things? I mean, like ML or AI.
Okay, so let me come back. Okay. Let me come back to this board. So sometimes, okay, sometimes you do a classification or a regression. Okay, so to, first of all, to answer your question, majority of the sign time, 70 to 80% of the cases, we use existing algorithms only. We don't devise new algorithms. That altogether is a big space, so which is very tough. We try to, which algorithm is right to use is also a big challenge when we are trying to solve. Okay, so sometimes if you go for machine learning algorithms, right, classification problems, the algorithm goes so depth. For example, I'll say you are dividing a decision, you are trying to divide a decision, it becomes very big, whether email is spam or not spam on so many variables. Okay, so the algorithm becomes complexity. No one knows what really inside it, how the decisions are taken. That's the reason people are saying, right, few people are saying AI is scaring people. So the computer is learning, but is it learning it in a right path or a wrong path? Okay, do humans have a control on understanding, is it learning it in the right thing or wrong thing, is a very tough judgment. You won't get an intuition of it. That's the complexity of data science or machine learning. So when few of the algorithms, they go in a very big neural networks, okay, you really don't know what was happening, but they give a result. So companies sometimes don't be here, understand, okay, oh, you say that your model is good. For example, you created a machine learning model, and which is going to give hikes to employees, some hypothetical. There is some decision which it took back, and all of a sudden employee was given a salary of a CTO. Okay, then it's a wrong. Okay, so but you want to revert it, you want to take a chance. So there are so many cases there. To answer your question, newer algorithms is not easy to do. And learning existing algorithms in a depth is a tough. You have to strike a balance. When you are saying you are a data scientist, you have to strike a balance.
Got it. Good. Thank you, Balaji.
Okay. Okay. So now, in this entire session, you guys use I use Linux, and Tableau. I want to show you the another. I want to show you, let me view full screen. So the visualization, this is a tool which we use, Tableau, because mine is a Linux machine, so I don't have Tableau desktop software running. I have a Windows virtual machine running on it. And similarly, that the same data set, right? So easy view. You just with two drags, you're able to see what's happening with your data. Okay, people with 7, they got 185, 6, they got 180. You really don't do this. So you can use Tableau to do visualization. And you need to use Anaconda to learn practice. So go for Linux. I'll record one session and share it to you, how to install and the basic spider tips and tricks cheat sheet, how to install spider cheat sheet and GitHub repositories. I'm going to share you. Okay. So it's just simple. You can go for, by the way, use Python 3.7. Python 3 is the future of the Python language, not Python 2. These entire sessions are covered in Python 3. Okay, So,
I have one question. In upcoming session, are you covering NLU topics? NLU, Natural Language Understanding.
No, I'm not going to cover. I'm just going to cover with till logistic regression only.
Okay.
That too in a depth. Whatever okay. You learn it in a depth. I assure you that.
Okay. NLP concepts?
No.
Okay.
So because this session 7 weeks, it's very tough to cover that. So, but if you are voluntary to share NLP which you learn to the group, I'm open. I can give you my bridge. You can teach to the team.
Okay. Sure, no problem. Means this class is only Saturday, Sunday or?
Only Saturday, 3 okay. to 4:30 p.m. 1.5 hour.
Okay, sure.
And this entire recording will be shared and the course contents will be shared and I am going to update my website and give you forward it to the people who want to join that WhatsApp group. In that WhatsApp group, I'll provide entire data.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Bala.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Have a nice day ahead. Have a nice weekend. By the way, Chandrayaan was not that successful. I was very unhappy. Last night, I went up till 1:30 a.m. to watch that. But sometimes that's the reality we have to accept. Thank you, friends. Bye.
Thank you, Balaji. Thanks for your time.
Yeah.
Bye.